Welcome to St. Patrick Catholic Community in Scottsdale, Arizona. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. And may these words of the Gospel remain forever on our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. On leaving the synagogue, Jesus entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Simon's mother-in-law lay sick with a fever. They immediately told him about her. He approached, grasped her hand, and helped her up. Then the fever left her, and she waited on them. When it was evening, after sunset, they brought to him all who were ill or possessed by demons. The whole town was gathered at the door. He cured many who were sick with various diseases, and he drove out many demons, not permitting them to speak, because they knew him. Rising very early before dawn, he left and went off to a deserted place where he prayed. Simon and those who were with him pursued him, and on finding him said, "Everyone is looking for you." He told them, "Let us go on to the nearby villages that I may preach there also. For this purpose have I come." So he went into their synagogues, preaching and driving out demons throughout the whole of Galilee. The gospel for this fifth Sunday in ordinary time is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 39. Today's gospel passage is part of a section of Mark where Jesus performs a series of healings and of expulsions of demons, the first miracles to be witnessed by the four men he has called to be his first disciples. These miracles are also presented in concert with his teaching, as you can see in chapter 1, verses 21 to 22. Jesus uses his power to heal as an illustration of his teaching, made very clear in chapter 1, verse 27. What is that teaching? Here is a summary of the first 28 verses of chapter 1. The first miracle in this section takes place in the synagogue of Capernaum on the Sabbath. And what it means is people come first, rules and regulations come later. The second miracle takes place the same day as the first and the same town. Jesus enters the home of the brothers Peter and Andrew, accompanied by the brothers John and James. Peter's mother-in-law is ill with a high fever. That Peter has a mother-in-law should be proof that some or even all of the apostles were married, a fact denied by some in our time who refuse to countenance the possibility of ordaining married men to the priesthood. Indeed, we can read in St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 9, verse 5, "Have we not every right to be accompanied by a Christian wife, like the other apostles, like the brothers of the Lord, and like Cephas?" This pre-gospel mention, by the way, of the brothers of the Lord as distinct from the apostles must cause some of our contemporaries to become agitated. Mary could not possibly have had other children than Jesus. She was and forever remained a virgin. That is what we are taught, and that is what Christian tradition has long and consistently affirmed. Back at Peter's mother-in-law's bedside, Jesus, moved with compassion, grasped the woman's hand and helped her up. The fever left her. She was cured, and as a gesture of appreciation, she waited on them. Service to others will be the hallmark of the Christian disciple. For those who believe that illness was a result of personal sin, this healing would also have had theological implications. Jesus not only heals bodies, he reconciles souls. In Luke's parallel passage of Mark's gospel, the reading is different, but it stresses that curing illness is related to exorcism. Here's what Luke writes in chapter 4, verse 39 of his gospel. Standing over her, and her is Peter's mother-in-law, Jesus rebuked the fever, and it left her. We see elsewhere that Jesus rebukes demons in Mark chapter 1, verse 25, and again in chapter 9, verse 25. Later that day, after sunset, and therefore after the Sabbath, many people, freed from the activity restrictions of the Sabbath, bring to Jesus their loved ones who are ill or possessed by demons. Jesus performs many healings and many exorcisms, but he refuses to allow the demons to speak because they knew him. At his baptism in the Jordan, Jesus alone heard the voice of the Father say, "You are my Son, the Beloved. My favor rests on you." Mark states that in chapter 1, verse 11. Matthew and Luke show Jesus gradually coming to understand what the Father's statement meant for him. Mark moves ahead much more quickly. Through the broad acceptance of his extraordinary teaching and of the performance of miracles, Jesus recognizes who he really is and what his mission is. For the time being, it is essential that his true identity not be broadcast. It would cause consternation and could lead many to question his sanity and suspect him of heresy. Mark shows us Jesus teaching and healing after sunset, after the conclusion of the Sabbath. The passage which follows and which concludes today's gospel passage presents Jesus rising before dawn. He leaves Capernaum and walks a significant distance to a deserted place where he prays. Morning prayers, customarily centered on the recitation of psalms, were a common practice among observant Jews. When Jesus is dying on the cross, he prays Psalm 22, verse 1, which reads, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Mark brings that to our attention in chapter 15, verse 34. But elsewhere and in multiple places in the Gospels, Jesus' prayer resembles a personal conversation with the Father, a heart-to-heart encounter. No psalms. For example, in the Garden of Gethsemane on Holy Thursday night, Jesus prays to his Father, saying, "Abba, Father, for you everything is possible. Take this cup away from me, but let it be as you, not I, would have it." Mark chapter 14, verse 36. Mark presents us with a scene of Jesus at prayer early in the morning. Prayer, a personal connection with God, is essential for true ministry. Successful ministry is not the result of any person's talents or charisma. It is always due entirely to grace from God, acting through the words or actions of the believer. We become the instruments of God's love, God acting through our words and example. Highlighting Peter's leadership role, Mark writes that Jesus is pursued by Simon and the others, who urge Jesus to return to Capernaum, where everyone is seeking him out. Jesus refuses. He has not come into the world nor inaugurated his mission to become the super celebrity of the town of Capernaum. He has come to bring the good news of salvation to as many people as possible. From the city of Capernaum, Jesus wants to travel to the surrounding villages, radiating his ministry through all of Galilee. And as he did in Capernaum, Jesus will enter the synagogues of those villages to preach, to heal, and to expel demons. Peter, Andrew, James, and John are witnessing exactly to what they have been called. Do you and I recognize ourselves as witnesses of Jesus in our words and actions? Like the apostles, we have been called to follow Jesus in word and deed. Difficult? Yes. Impossible? Of course, unless done in union with God as the principal agent. Jesus said, by human resources, it is impossible, but not for God, because for God, everything is possible. Mark chapter 10, verse 27. And again in Mark chapter 11, verses 24 and 25, Jesus says, I tell you, therefore, everything you ask and pray for, believe that you have it already, and it will be yours. And when you stand in prayer, forgive whatever you have against anybody, so that your Father in heaven may forgive your failings too. Mark's gospel contains no passage resembling the Lord's Prayer as found in Matthew 6 and Luke 11, but this comes close. That God may bring about success in our ministries requires that we be forgiving of others, that God may forgive us. By this is our ministry fully qualified. Easy? We all know it is not, but it is essential. As Pope Francis wrote, the name of God is mercy. Mercy must also be our name. God bless you all, and thank you very much.